Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, At a Crossroads, the intersection of the CARES Act, the PPP, and the FFCRA. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. And since there are so many online today, and I know many more of us are working remotely, I wanted to call out a couple of extra resources in case anyone starts having audio problems or other technical problems. You could please see the webcast helpful hints next to the presentation slides, especially the F5 to refresh your browser. That's usually very successful. And there's also a question mark help widget at the bottom that will link you to common solutions to technical problems. And lastly, I would recommend that if you are on a company network or VPN, if there's any way you can temporarily log off of that, I would recommend that you do that as well, if that's possible for you. And while we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download, along with additional resources you may find useful in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. And as a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have an additional slide at the end to serve as instructions on how to access your certification. And your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email sent out 24 hours after the event. Also, I'd like to quickly review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics, especially this topic. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Virginia Neiswender and Stacey Williams. Virginia is senior counsel supporting ADP's National Account Services business. She's been a practicing attorney for over 15 years with experience as counsel at the federal government, in private practice, and as in-house counsel. Virginia specializes in compliance issues related to employment benefits, including ERISA, leave administration, and benefits-related employment tax. Stacey is senior counsel in ADP's global compliance organization. Stacey has been a practicing attorney for more than 20 years, representing employers both at large law firms and as in-house counsel. With a practice focusing on employment law and general corporate compliance, Stacey is a frequent speaker on topics including leave and disability issues, absence management, and wage and hour compliance. With that, Stacey, I know you and Virginia have a lot you want to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
Thanks, Karen. Welcome, everyone, to today's session, the intersection of the CARES Act, the PPP, and the FFCRA. We have a packed agenda today, and we'll cover the legislation passed by the United States federal government in response to the COVID-19 crisis. Specifically, we're going to examine the impact on employers of the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, or FFCRA, the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act, or CARES Act, and the Paycheck Protection Program, which is a major part of the CARES Act. We will share insights into how all of these measures relate to each other and some issues for employers to consider in deciding which of them to take advantage of. We have a lot to cover today, so let's get started. Our focus today is on two new far-reaching pieces of legislation. But first, let's look at how we got here and how fast things are moving. In response to the COVID-19 pandemic, governments all over the world have enacted fiscal and monetary stimulus measures to counteract the uncertainty and economic downturn caused by the coronavirus. Here in the United States, the U.S. Federal Reserve has taken significant steps to provide monetary stimulus, and Congress has passed and the President has signed legislation to help individuals, businesses, and certain industries through the crisis. On March 6, 2020, President Trump signed the first stimulus. The first stimulus was an $8.3 billion spending bill intended to fund efforts to fight the pandemic. It didn't directly address employers and employees, so we won't cover that today. On March 11th, the World Health Organization officially declared COVID-19 to be a pandemic. On March 18th, 2020, the Families First Coronavirus Response Act was signed into law. This law is more commonly referred to as the Families First Act, or FFCRA. This second stimulus package created new paid sick leave and paid family leave programs for employers with fewer than 500 employees and corresponding new tax credits. On March 27, 2020, the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act, or CARES Act, was signed. This third stimulus package is the largest stimulus package to date, costing approximately $2.2 trillion. We will cover several of the major provisions of the CARES Act today, including the Paycheck Protection Program, or PPP, and payroll tax deferral provisions. The PPP ran out of money within 12 days, so Congress scrambled to add more funds. On April 24, 2020, the Paycheck Protection Program and Healthcare Enhancement Act was signed. It appropriated another $484 billion, including $320 billion for the Paycheck Protection Program, as well as other funds for economic injury disaster loans and emergency grants under the CARES Act, and to fund hospital and provider recovery and testing. How fast are things moving? Well, usually substantial legislation like this takes many months and sometimes years to form, with input from many stakeholders along the way as it makes its way through the legislative process. Because of the pandemic crisis, these bills were rushed through at record speed and in some cases with incomplete information and agency guidance. This creates challenges as government agencies, banks, employers, individuals, and providers are forced to react at lightning speed. Let's start by taking a closer look at the relevant provisions of the Families First Act. The Families First Act was the first major law directly impacting employers passed in response to the COVID-19 crisis. The public policy behind the act is to enable employers to keep employees on their payrolls while at the same time ensuring that employees are not forced to choose between their paychecks and the public health measures needed to combat the virus. Keep in mind that this law applies to public employers and to private employers with fewer than 500 employees. It has three main components. For covered employers, Families First adds a new reason to the possible reasons for employees to take FMLA leave. It also makes leave taken for that new reason paid. Employees may take this new emergency paid FMLA leave if the employee is unable to work or unable to work from home due to childcare needs like the employee's child's school or daycare being closed because of the pandemic. Keep in mind that traditional FMLA leave is normally 12 weeks. This amendment simply adds another reason for FMLA leave and makes this particular leave paid. That is to say, it's not an additional 12 weeks of time. The FFCRA also provides emergency paid sick leave to eligible employees. Emergency paid sick leave is available for six different reasons that you see on your screen. The first three reasons relate to the employee's own health condition, and the second three reasons occur when an employee is caring for someone else affected by the crisis. You may have noticed that the only reason covered by the FMLA expansion, that is, being unable to work, whether at a work location or at home due to childcare needs, is also a reason for emergency paid sick leave. The final provision of the Families First Act is that employers are entitled to take tax credits for payments made to employees for these leaves, which we'll discuss in a moment. Under the emergency FMLA expansion portion of the FFCRA, full-time employees may take 12 total weeks of leave between April 1st and December 31st of 2020. That amount is prorated for part-time employees based on how many hours they are normally scheduled to work. An employee is eligible for emergency FMLA after 30 days of employment, which is much earlier than the traditional FMLA eligibility period. The first 2 weeks of emergency FMLA leave can be unpaid, but the employee can use any or a combination of the following entitlements to cover that time: PTO, including vacation, personal, or sick leave provided by the employer, paid state or local sick leave if applicable, and emergency paid sick leave under the FFCRA. The remaining 10 weeks of emergency FMLA are paid at two-thirds of the employee's regular rate of pay. There are caps on the amounts employers are required to pay and, correspondingly, the amount of tax credits an employer can take. For emergency paid family leave, the cap is $200 a day and $10,000 total per employee. For emergency paid sick leave, full-time employees are entitled to 80 hours paid sick leave, which is prorated for part-time employees. This total hourly entitlement applies per employee, even if the employee changes employers. This raises an interesting question. How are employers supposed to know about paid sick leave taken at a previous employer? We're waiting for clarification on this from the Department of Labor, but the reality is that people really aren't switching jobs too much right now, so practically it may not be that much of an issue. Amounts paid to employees taking emergency paid sick leave and corresponding credits are also capped. The limit is up to $511 per day and $5,110 in the aggregate per employee for employees taking leave for the first three leave reasons, which relate to the employee's own health. For leave reasons 4 through 6, which contemplate leave taken to care for others, the limit is up to $200 a day and $2,000 in the aggregate per employee. Let's move on to some exemptions. There are limits on these new leave obligations in addition to the fact that the law only applies to public employers and private employers with fewer than 500 employees. Employers of healthcare workers and emergency responders are not required to provide these employees with emergency FMLA if they do not choose to do so. Also, employers with fewer than 50 employees may qualify for exemption from the requirement to provide leave due to school closings or childcare unavailability if the leave requirements would jeopardize the viability of the business as a going concern. If an employer has fewer than 25 employees, the employer is not obligated to return the employee to work after the leave if the employer meets certain hardship conditions. That is, there's not a reinstatement right for the worker in those cases. The emergency paid sick leave law has the same exemptions for employers of healthcare workers and emergency responders, but the exemption for employers with fewer than 50 employees only applies in the case of leave for childcare reasons, not for the remaining possible reasons for paid sick leave under the law. Now we'll move on to our first polling question.
Yes, thank you so much, Stacey. We are. So at this point, you should be seeing the first polling question on your screen. And our question, our first question today is, have you had employees request to take paid sick or paid family leave under the FFCRA? And your possible answers here are pretty straightforward. It's yes, we have had employees request. No, we have not had employees request, or you are unsure. I'm going to give my first CPE reminder. for those that you would like credit, so please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And if for some reason you're not seeing the question in the slide area, you can use the Q&A to respond. I'll read the question one more time. It is, have you had employees request to take paid sick or paid family leave under the FFCRA? Your possible responses are yes, no, or you aren't sure. Let me give you just a couple more seconds. Okay, Stacey, you should see the results on the screen now.
Thanks, Karen. Okay, well, it looks like at least we're roughly half, a little less than half of our audience does have employees who have asked to take leave under the FFCRA. And for those that do have employees taking leave under this law, you'll want to know about the tax credits available to employers for providing leave under the Families First Act. Specifically, employers are entitled to credits for the following amounts paid. One, paid sick or paid family leave payments, plus qualified health insurance costs, if any, related to the employees who received the paid leave payments, plus the amount of the employer portion of Medicare taxes paid on the paid leave payments. The tax credit offsets or reduces the amount of federal employment taxes that must be deposited with the IRS, usually within a few days of the payroll date. This is intended to provide employers with the funds needed to allow them to pay paid sick leave and paid family leave benefits under the Families First Act. I'm going to turn it back to Karen for our second polling question.
Thank you so much, Stacey. So yes, we have a couple back-to-back right here. So at this point, you should be seeing the second survey question on your screen, polling question. And the question is, how many weeks of FMLA leave are eligible employees entitled to take, including traditional FMLA, and paid family leave under the FFCRA? And your possible responses are, it's 10 weeks, it's 12 weeks, it's 14 weeks, or it is unlimited. I'll give my second CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit to please make sure you respond to the question, and I'll read it out one more time. How many weeks of FMLA leave are eligible employees entitled to take if you include traditional FMLA and paid family leave under the FFCRA? Is it 10 weeks, 12 weeks, 14 weeks, or unlimited? Okay, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Well, looks like most of our audience got it right, because the answer is that eligible employees are entitled to take 12 total weeks of FMLA leave, whether under the traditional FMLA or new paid emergency FMLA leave under the FFCRA. We discussed the fact that FFCRA applies only to employers with fewer than 500 employees. So it's important to remember that some employees may be eligible only for traditional FMLA and not FFCRA leave. For example, those working for employers with more than 500 employees. Some may be eligible only for emergency FMLA under the FFCRA, such as employees working for employers with fewer than 50 employees, while some may be eligible for both types of FMLA leave. For those employers that are eligible or employees that are eligible for both, keep in mind that the total entitlement is limited to 12 weeks. So, for example, an employee who took FMLA for their own serious health conditions for 3 weeks in January of 2020 would be eligible only for another total 9 weeks of FMLA leave, whether for the standard reasons or to care for a son or daughter whose school or place of care is closed or unavailable due to COVID-19 per FFCRA. Another point we wanted to clarify was when an employer needs to make the calculation of how many employees it has. According to the Department of Labor, the fewer than 500 employee calculation needs to be conducted at the time each employee goes out on leave. Also, in counting employees, an employer needs to include employees on leave, temporary employees who are jointly employed by the employer and another employer, and employees supplied by a temporary agency. One more item to note, Employees who have been furloughed because the employer does not have work for them to perform are not entitled to take paid sick or paid family leave under the FFCRA. And with that, I'll turn it over to Virginia to talk about the CARES Act.
Thank you, Stacey, and good afternoon, everyone. The Coronavirus Act, the Corona Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act, or CARES Act, was enacted on March 27th, and we've seen a flurry of changes since then. There are many components of the CARES Act, including retirement, unemployment insurance expansion, employer payments of student loans, the Paycheck Protection Program, payroll tax deferrals, employee retention credits, and other loan options. Let's first talk about the Paycheck Protection Program, or PPP. This slide provides a summary of the key provisions of the PPP that we will dig into in a moment. The PPP is meant for employers with 500 or fewer employees, although certain exceptions do apply. The program currently goes through June 30, 2020, and certain amounts will be forgivable based upon employment and wage levels being maintained. Businesses must have been in operation with employees on February 15, 2020 to qualify. The loan amounts are 250% of average monthly payroll costs and are determined based on a 12-month look-back period with a cap of $10 million. There are also affiliation rules that apply generally that may limit eligibility for larger firms and private equity entities. Speaking of affiliation rules, you've probably heard some media stories about some larger organizations that have applied for and received PPP loans. The Small Business Administration released an FAQ reminding companies that all borrowers should review carefully the required certification that, quote, current economic uncertainty makes this loan request necessary to support the ongoing operations of the application, end quote. Borrowers must make this certification in good faith, taking into account their current business activity and their ability to access other sources of liquidity sufficient to support their ongoing operations in a manner that is not significantly detrimental to the business. For example, it is unlikely that a public company with substantial market value and access to capital markets will be able to make the required certification in good faith, and such a company should be prepared to demonstrate to the SBA upon request the basis for its certifications. There are a few other limitations on what types of businesses are eligible for PPP loans, but lawsuits have already been filed challenging some of them. For example, a group of strip clubs in Michigan and Wisconsin have challenged limitations barring them from obtaining PPP loans based on their generating revenue from entertainment of a purient sexual nature. A group of political consultants also challenged the prohibition against their organizations receiving PPP loans and applied for a temporary restraining order, but a federal court denied that request, finding the SBA regulation was viewpoint neutral and does not suppress certain ideas or beliefs in favor of others based upon their affiliations or viewpoints. We suspect that there will be more lawsuits related to PPP loans in the future. I'll now turn it over to Karen for a third polling question.
Thank you so much, Virginia. So at this time, you should be seeing the third polling question on your screen. And our question here is a pretty straightforward one. It is, have you already applied or do you plan to apply for a PPP loan? Your possible responses are yes, you have, or you plan to. No, you've not, and you do not plan to. Or you are unsure. I'm also going to give my third CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit. Please make sure you respond to the question to qualify, and I'll read it one more time. Have you already applied, or do you plan to apply for a PPP loan? Your possible responses are yes, no, or unsure. I'm going to give you all about 5 more seconds to respond. Okay, you should be seeing the results on the screen now, Virginia.
Thank you, Karen. It looks like a large number of folks, 64% of our audience, has applied for a plan on applying for a PPP loan. So let's get into some more detail. For the PPP, an applicant business must satisfy two criteria. First, the size of the applicant alone without affiliates must not exceed the applicable size standard. And two, the size of the applicant combined with its affiliates must not exceed the size standard designated for either the primary industry of the applicant alone or the primary industry of the applicant of its affiliates, whichever is higher. Entities are affiliates of each other when one controls or has the power to control the other, or a third party or parties control or has the power to control both. It does not matter whether control is actually exercised, so long as a power to control exists. Affiliations may be found based upon any of the fact-specific tests you see on your screen. As a result of a waiver of the affiliation rules in certain cases, hotel and restaurant chains may qualify for these loans, despite their size. The SBA's affiliation rules also are waived for franchises that are approved on the SBA's franchise directory and small businesses that receive financing through the Small Business Investment Company program. As noted earlier, the PPP loans are generally 250% of the average monthly payroll cost, taking into account the average wages paid during the applicable period, capped at $10 million. The applicable period can be either the one-year period prior to the loan or calendar year 2019. There are also alternative look-back periods for employers who are seasonal, or new employers. For purposes of calculating the payroll costs, businesses need to take into account all of the elements you see on the left-hand side of your screen and excluding from payroll costs those listed on the right. The PPP limits the purposes for which loan proceeds can be used if a business wants to request full or partial forgiveness of the PPP loan. The proceeds can be used for payroll costs, as defined on the previous slide, rent, utilities, mortgage obligations, and interest on debts incurred before the covered period or the 8-week period after loan disbursement. Payroll costs plus interest paid on any covered mortgage, covered rent, and covered utility payments can be forgiven, but note that no more than 25% of the forgiven amount can be for non-payroll costs. To the extent a PPP loan is not forgiven, the loan matures 2 years after disbursement of the funds, and interest accrues at a 1% fixed rate. Under CARES Act, payment is deferred for a 6-month period. However, interest continues to accrue during that deferral period. Forgiveness of a PPP loan can be granted for the sum of allowable costs incurred during the 8-week period commencing on the date of loan origination or disbursement. To obtain forgiveness, the employer will need to work with their lender. There are few specific details at this point, but businesses definitely will need to document verification of the numbers of employees on their payroll as well as their pay rate, including IRS payroll tax filings as well as state income, payroll, and unemployment insurance filings. Businesses will also need documentation to show payments for mortgage, lease, and utility obligations, as well as certification that the information is true and correct, and that the amount being forgiven was used in accordance with their program requirements. In connection with the 8-week loan forgiveness period, some employers have wondered whether they need to adjust their payroll cycles to a weekly basis from their normal biweekly or other payment frequency to correspond to the PPP loan forgiveness period. The short answer is no. There is no requirement in the law or regulations that employers begin paying employees on a weekly basis to correspond with the 8-week PPP forgiveness period. Moreover, changing pay periods may well create more problems than it actually solves for a number of reasons. First, unless an employer happens to receive the loan proceeds on the beginning date of their pay period, the employer will still have to deal with partial pay periods including at the beginning and end of the 8-week period. Also, in many jurisdictions, state or local wage theft and wage payment laws mandate a certain notice period and written notification before pay periods can be changed. Finally, anytime an employer changes the timing or frequency of paying its employees, it creates the risk of underpayments, overpayments, and delayed payments to employees, all of which have the potential to create not only headaches, but liability for the employer. Now let's move on to the Economic Injury, Disaster Loans, and Grants Program. The CARES Act also expanded the SBA's existing Economic Injury Disaster Loans, or EIDL, program to businesses with 500 or fewer employees, sole proprietorships, and independent contractors. The program also includes a grant provision. These grants provide an emergency advance of up to $10,000 to small businesses and private nonprofits harmed by COVID-19 within 3 days of applying for an EIDL. To access the advance, you first apply for an EIDL and then request the advance. The advance does not need to be repaid under any circumstances and may be used to keep employees on payroll to pay for sick leave, meet increased production costs due to supply chain disruptions, or pay business obligations, including debts, rent, and mortgage payments. The EIDLs are low-interest loans of up to $2 million, with principal and interest deferrals at the SBA's discretion. Eligible businesses that suffer substantial economic injury as the result of a disaster or emergency, which now includes COVID-19, can apply for an EIDL through December 31st, 2020. EIDL proceeds can be used to pay for expenses that could have been met had the disaster not occurred, including payroll and other operating expenses. Under the CARES Act, the SBA will relax or waive certain rules and requirements for loan eligibility. The EIDL will bear a low rate of interest, but unlike a PPP loan, is not eligible for forgiveness. Let's now turn to the issue of employee retention credits. As an encouragement for employers to retain employees during the pandemic, the CARES Act provides employers with a refundable tax credit equal to 50% of qualified wages up to $10,000 for each employee for a maximum credit of $5,000 per employee. An employer is eligible for the employee retention credit for qualified wages paid after March 12th and before January 1st, 2021, if either, one, the operations have been fully or partially suspended due to a governmental order limiting commerce, travel, or group meetings for things such as commercial, social, religious, or other purposes related to COVID-19, or two, the business experienced a decline in gross receipts of more than 50% compared to the same quarter of the prior year. Unlike the PPP, employers of any size are entitled to take an employee retention credit. If the employer has more than 100 employees, the credit is available for wages paid to employees not providing services during the shutdown. If the employer has 100 or fewer employees, all wages, regardless of whether employees are providing services, qualify. The employee retention credit has some important nuances and limitations. First, health plan expenses are eligible for the tax credit, but count toward the maximum credit amount. Employers applying for and receiving a PPP loan cannot take advantage of this particular tax credit. In addition, the same wages used for the FFCRA credits for paid sick and paid family leave cannot be used to claim the employee retention credit. There's no double dipping. And finally, if an employer has taken a work opportunity tax credit, the same wages for the same period of time cannot be used for the employee retention credit. Let's turn now to an opportunity to delay the payment of certain employment taxes. All employers, regardless of size, are eligible to defer the employer portion of the Social Security taxes under this provision of the CARES Act. Employers pay Social Security taxes at a rate of 6.2% on the first $137,700 of wages paid to employees for calendar year 2020. The CARES Act allows all employers to defer payment of employer Social Security taxes that are otherwise owed for wage payments made on or after March 27, 2020, through the end of calendar year 2020. Instead of depositing these taxes on a next day or semi-weekly basis, the tax due date for 50% of the taxes is deferred to December 31, 2021, with the remaining 50% deferred until December 31, 2022. Also, unlike the previously discussed tax credits, this is a delay rather than an elimination of the employer portion of the Social Security tax. Let's turn it to Karen for the last polling question.
Thank you so much, Virginia. So at this point, everyone should be seeing this final polling question on their screen. And our question is, which of the following is not a condition for forgiveness of a PPP loan? So option one is the loan proceeds are spent or qualifying costs are incurred within 8 weeks receipt of the loan proceeds. Option two is in the 8 week period immediately following disbursement of the loan, at least 75% of funds are used for payroll costs and no more than 25% is used for other approved uses. Option three is all previous deferred Social Security taxes are paid within 8 weeks of receipt of the loan proceeds. And option four is staffing and pay levels must be maintained during the 8 week period immediately following disbursement of the loan. Give my final CPE reminder and I'll read it one more time. And if you're having a problem, you can just say 1, 2, 3, 4 in the Q&A box. So it's which of the following is not a condition for forgiveness of a PPP loan? And option one is the loan proceeds are spent or qualifying costs are incurred within 8 weeks of receipt of the loan proceeds. Option two is in the 8 week period immediately following disbursement of the loan, at least 75% of funds are used for payroll costs and no more than 25% is used for other approved uses. Option three is all previously deferred Social Security taxes are paid within 8 weeks of receipt of the loan proceeds. And option four is staffing and pay levels must be maintained during the 8 week period immediately following disbursement of the loan. Okay, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Thanks, Karen. Well, it looks like most everybody got it right. The correct answer is, in fact, all previously deferred Social Security taxes are paid within 8 weeks of receipt of the loan proceeds. In fact, eligible businesses can defer Social Security taxes until they are notified that their loan has been forgiven. If and when the business is notified that the bank has forgiven the loan, the business does not have to pay the deferred SS taxes immediately. Rather, the amounts are continued to be deferred until December 31st, 2021 and December 31st, 2022. Let's take a moment to discuss how employers go about claiming tax credits available to them and how advance payments of employer credits under the FFCRA and CARES Act will work. Employers have three options for taking advantage of the various tax options. One, they can offset their employment taxes that they deposit with the IRS. Two, they can request an advance payment via Form 7200 or request a refund via the quarterly employment tax filings. In the first method, employers may reduce deposits of employment taxes and report the reduction on the employer's tax returns. The IRS has provided an example of how this would work. If an eligible employer paid $5,000 in sick leave and is otherwise required to deposit $8,000 in payroll taxes, including taxes withheld from all its employees, the employer could use up to $5,000 of the $8,000 of taxes it was going to deposit for making qualified leave payments. The employer would only be required under the law to deposit the remaining $3,000 on its next regular deposit date. The second option is for the employer to file a Form 7200. If the employer believes that the employment taxes are insufficient to cover the entire credit to which it would be entitled, the employer may request an advance from the IRS. Finally, the credits are refundable amounts that can be claimed on the employer's quarterly employment tax returns, filed at the end of each calendar quarter. The mechanism for claiming these amounts will be through the Form 941 that employers are required to file each quarter. The IRS has issued a new Form 7200 on which an employer can provide an estimate of its credit for the calendar quarter and request an advance payment of the credit. The IRS has indicated if there are not enough payroll taxes to cover the reimbursement of the credit, employers may file a request for an accelerated payment using the new form. This applies for the FFCRA credits as well as the CARES Act employee retention credit. The IRS expects to process these requests in 2 weeks or less. So what is the timeline and process for filing Form 7200? On April 1st, the IRS issued the final form and instructions. Employers are not required to file Form 7200. Employers wishing to do so may file Form 7200 multiple times throughout the quarter at any time before the end of the month following the quarter in which they paid the qualified wages. If they file a Form 7200 multiple times within a quarter, they are only entitled to any additional credit that they are due for that quarter since their last 7200 filing. For your convenience, we've included a screenshot of the Form 7200 and a link to the form on the IRS website. Before filing, an employer will need to collect information to calculate the amount of the advance credit, taking into account amounts paid in qualified wages and amounts already claimed against employment taxes. Keep in mind, you'll need to maintain copies of the Form 7200 so that you can reconcile your employment taxes at the end of the quarter. Keep in mind that an employer may only request an advance of the various credits to the extent the employer has not already reduced their employment taxes by the requested amount. The IRS provides the following additional example to illustrate the advance payment under Form 7200, continuing from the example discussed a few slides before. If an employer is entitled to an employee retention credit of $10,000 and was required to deposit $8,000 in employment taxes, the employer could retain the entire $8,000 of taxes as a portion of the refundable tax credit it is entitled to, and then file a request for an advance payment for the remaining $2,000 using Form 7200. Let's now turn to the new Form 941. The IRS has announced tax return filing extensions and extensions of time to take other tax-related actions in response to COVID-19. However, the IRS did not extend the due date for filing Form 941, employers' quarterly federal tax return, for the first quarter of 2020. Employers generally must report wages paid during quarter one, which is January through March, by April 30th. Eligible employers who paid qualified wages with respect to the employee retention credit between March 13, 2020 and March 31, 2020 inclusive have been asking how they should take advantage of this particular credit, wondering whether to include the amount on their quarter one Form 941. The IRS has instructed employers to report the employee retention credit on Form 941 for the second quarter of 2020 and not to include the employee retention credit on their first quarter Form 941. This means the eligible employer will report 50% of those wages together with 50% of any qualified wages paid during April, May, and June 2020 on their second quarter Form 941 to claim that credit. On April 30th, the IRS released a draft of the updated Form 941 that employers will be able to use for their second quarter tax filing, along with instructions and a worksheet. Many lines have been added to the form, including entries for qualified sick leave wages, qualified family leave wages, the non-refundable portion of credit for qualified sick and family leave wages as calculated on the worksheet, non-refundable portion of employee retention credit as calculated on the worksheet, total non-refundable credits, and a line for others. Notably, the form and instructions were released only in draft form, so we are still waiting for final guidance on what the form will look like and how it will work. Now back to you, Stacy.
Thanks, Virginia. We've covered the highlights of the major provisions of the Families First and CARES Acts that impact employers. Now we're going to take a moment to talk about how they all fit together. The CARES Act and the FFCRA provide a number of different options for loans with different eligibility requirements and allowable uses, as well as tax credits and deferrals. Leveraging one program could preclude or limit participation in another. Employers need to evaluate the requirements and benefits of each and determine what is the best option. We'll start with a quick recap of some of the major avenues of relief we've discussed today. One type of relief available to all employers, regardless of size, is the payroll tax deferral. As we've discussed, it allows employers to defer paying their portion of Social Security taxes otherwise due, with 50% of the amount due at the end of 2021 and 50% at the end of 2022. This deferral is available to an employer that receives a PPP loan until it receives notice from the lender that the loan is forgiven, and the employer may continue to defer any payroll tax that it deferred prior to loan forgiveness in accordance with CARES Act rules. On this slide, we've summarized possible tax credits. The FFCRA provides fully refundable credits for the amount paid to employees who take paid sick or paid family leave, not just for the wages paid to employees, but also for the cost of providing or maintaining health insurance for the employees, plus the employer portion of Medicare taxes. The Employee Retention Credit and the CARES Act, under the CARES Act, is a credit against employment taxes equal to 50% of qualified wages with a maximum credit of $5,000 per employee, and the employer has to experience a full or partial shutdown or 50% decline in gross receipts for eligibility. Businesses with more than 100 employees that are fully or partially shut down are only entitled to claim the credit for employees who are not providing services. Employers cannot take advantage of both this particular credit and a PPP loan. Finally, are loan options. The Paycheck Protection Program provides for loans of up to $10 million for small businesses, that is 500 or fewer employees, impacted by COVID-19. Payroll-based information determines the loan amount and can be used to pay payroll, rent, utilities, and other expenses. There are two other loan types available, EIDLs and SBA Express loans, which we've really not had time to cover in detail. But you can see an overview of the requirements here and note that all loans are subject to affiliation rules that will determine whether an entity is eligible or not. Keep in mind that a business could request these additional loans plus a loan under PPP. However, the proceeds from the additional SBA loans cannot overlap with the use of the PPP proceeds. One question that arises when we think about how the different provisions work together is whether the actions of one affiliate limit or affect the options available to other affiliated entities. The short answer is maybe if the affiliated entities are considered a single employer. Some of you in the audience may be familiar with the so-called control group analysis. And as Virginia mentioned earlier, determination of whether multiple entities constitute a single employer for purposes of the affiliation rules requires a nuanced and fact-specific inquiry, and ADP recommends that companies grappling with this question consult with their legal or tax advisors for advice on their unique situations. In general, though, what does this mean for you? Well, let's look at an example. Let's say Company A receives a PPP loan. Can Company B, which is an affiliate of Company A, receive an employee retention credit? The answer, in short, is it depends on the relationship between Company A and B. If Company A and Company B are treated as a single employer, then one company cannot receive a PPP loan if the other received the retention tax credit. The next few slides are intended to walk you through how the CARES Act and FFCRA provisions work together, including identifying when election of one provision precludes the availability of other relief. To help our audience understand the different options available to small businesses, we're going to walk through the case study of a hypothetical business. The business in our study, Tony's Terrific Trivets, was doing a booming business prior to the COVID-19 crisis. However, due to local restrictions on non-essential businesses, Tony's has had to shut down its brick-and-mortar store and is moving to an online model. Before the crisis, Tony's employed 10 full-time employees, all of whom had been employed for the last 12 months. Tony's monthly rent plus utilities was $4,000 per month, and monthly payroll costs were $50,000 a month. Sensitive to slower sales, Tony's was considering its options when two of its employees requested leave under the Families First Act. I'll turn it back to Virginia to walk through the various ways these provisions might play out for this business.
Thank you, Stacey. Let's assume that Tony's is just beginning to consider how to preserve cash reserves and hasn't decided whether to go the PPP route, employee retention route, or any other specifics. Tony's first decision is to defer the employer portion of Social Security. Tony's wants to see how else the business can maximize the available relief. Tony's may want to consider applying for a PPP loan and eventually requesting loan forgiveness. If Tony's does apply and then receives forgiveness, Tony's would have to stop deferring Social Security taxes and would remain liable for already deferred amounts to be paid in equal amounts on December 31st, 2021 and December 31st, 2022. However, deferring the employer portion of Social Security taxes will not impact the business's ability to apply for and receive a PPP loan and EIDL or to be eligible for the credits we've discussed. So let's look at what other options the business may have. Tony's needs to consider whether the business will have to provide paid leave to his employees who need leave. One employee has tested positive for COVID-19, and the other is unable to work due to his child's daycare being closed due to COVID-19. Tony's business has fewer than 500 employees. The employees seeking leave are not healthcare workers or first responders. And Tony's doesn't think that paying for these two employees to go out on leave will jeopardize the ability of the business to continue as a going concern. So Tony's will need to let these employees go out on leave. The first employee will take paid leave for 2 weeks. Since the leave is due to the employee's own illness, the employee is entitled to paid sick leave of up to $511 per day and a total of $5,110 for those 2 weeks. The other employee who needs leave to care for a child whose place of care is closed due to COVID-19 is entitled to take both paid sick leave and paid family leave under the FFCRA. For paid sick leave, he will be entitled to 2 weeks paid leave up to a maximum of $200 per day and a total of $2,000. If he still needs leave after that, he will be entitled to an additional 10 weeks of paid family leave at a rate of up to $200 per day and subject to a $10,000 maximum per employee. Tony's will be entitled to a fully refundable tax credit for amounts paid to those employees as paid leave under the FFCRA. Some other considerations include the business can take a credit by reducing employment taxes paid to the IRS by the total qualifying wages paid to the two employees. It can also continue to defer any remaining employer Social Security taxes from each payroll. The business can still apply for a PPP loan and/or an EIDL loan. However, if the business requests loan forgiveness for the PPP loan, the paid leaves under the FFCRA for which tax credits were taken cannot be included as payroll costs for purposes of meeting loan forgiveness requirements. And finally, the business also cannot use the same wages paid for sick leave for purposes of claiming the employee retention credit. While Tony's two employees are out on leave under the FFCRA, Tony decides to apply for a PPP loan. Tony's can apply for a loan of up to 250% of average monthly costs from the 12-month look-back period. Assuming Tony's payroll costs seen on your screen haven't changed over the past 12 months, he can apply for a loan of $171,687.50, even though he has already been deferring payment of the employer portion of Social Security taxes. Now he's wondering how taking that loan will affect other relief that might be available to his business. Let's say Tony applies for a PPP loan on April 15th. The business had already been deferring payment of the employer portion of Social Security taxes and can continue to do so while the PPP loan is being processed. Let's say the loan is approved on April 27th and the first disbursement of the loan proceeds occurs on April 28th. Tony's cannot use any of the loan proceeds to pay for the cost of paid sick and paid family leave for his two employees. But Tony's knows the business will be entitled to separate credit for those amounts. Tony's can continue to defer payment of the employer portion of Social Security taxes until the bank issues a notification that the PPP loan has been forgiven. Assuming Tony uses at least 75% of the PPP loan funds for payroll costs and the rest for other costs acceptable for loan forgiveness, the loan should be forgiven. If Tony's receives notification on October 1st, 2020, that the PPP loan has been forgiven, the business must stop deferring the employer portion of Social Security taxes and must start paying them again from that date forward. PPP Tony does not have to pay the Social Security taxes that were already deferred right away, however. Rather, half of the amount already deferred will be due on December 31, 2021, and the other half on December 31, 2022. If Tony receives a PPP loan, the business will not be eligible for the employee retention credit. CARES Act Section 2301L3 specifically requires Treasury to issue regulatory guidance on how the IRS will recoup the tax credit if an employer receives a credit and then receives a PPP loan. So it appears an employer eligible for PPP loan will not be affected by taking the tax credit. Rather, there will be some form of repayment or offset of the tax credit if the employer also later receives a PPP loan. In this regard, taking the tax credit may affect the amount of forgiveness available, meaning a reduction in the amount of loan forgiveness may be how Treasury decides to recoup the tax. However, given the current lack of guidance, we simply do not have certainty on what position the Treasury will take. Let's imagine an alternative scenario where Tony's decides not to apply for a PPP loan. Instead, Tony's decided to use an employee retention credit. As we discussed earlier, the employee retention credit under the CARES Act is a credit against employment taxes equal to 50% of qualified wages of the first $10,000 of wages paid to an employee, up to a maximum of a $5,000 credit per employee. In order to be eligible for this credit, the employer has to experience full or partial shutdown or 50% decline in gross receipts. Assuming Tony's gross receipts are down by at least 50%, he is eligible to take an employee retention credit. Because Tony has fewer than 100 employees, this means that wages for all of Tony's employees who are not paid leave will qualify for purposes of this tax credit. In addition, Tony's can defer any remaining employer Social Security taxes and is entitled to the FFCRA tax credits for those employees on paid leave. Tony's will need to make sure tax credits are only taken for the wages paid under either the CARES Act or FFCRA. On this slide, we have provided an easy reference summarizing what we have discussed today. The interplay of the FCRA and CARES Act provisions, including the PPP, requires businesses to fairly carefully consider how the relief will support the business's circumstances and needs. While many of the provisions can work in concert, businesses should carefully plan which wages we'll use for the available tax credits, whether the payroll tax deferral makes sense, and keep tabs on any payroll tax deferrals for future payment. The various agencies tasked with implementing FFCRA and CARES Act continue to issue clarifying and new guidance each day, which may affect how the provisions working going forward. Thank you for joining us today. Stay safe, stay strong, and stay positive. Now back to you, Karen.
Thank you so much, Virginia and Stacy, for all of that valuable information. So we are at the top of the hour, so unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. I did want to call out in the resource list next to the slides, in addition to the slides being there, there is also a link to a toolkit that we have put together for employers, and that includes links to a lot of FAQs because we got a lot of questions today, a lot regarding PPP. There's also a link to a PPP guide there that I would encourage you to leverage those assets. Definitely take advantage of all that information. And as a reminder, your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And to receive ongoing communications from ABP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. For more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our Spark blog link shown on the screen. And lastly, you can register for additional Workplace Spotlight webinars using the link shown on the screen as well. And on behalf of all of our speakers, myself, and the entire team at ABP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you again, and I hope everyone out there continues to stay safe.